and a very warm welcome to St George's on this, what feels really extraordinary occasion actually, I'm not quite sure how else to describe it, as we say farewell to Tim after 6 years of amazing service and ministry in this church, in this church community and in the wider community in Greenwich. We are going to be giving thanks for that ministry. Thanks for Tim and for Caroline and for all that they've shared with us over the last 6 years.
And it does seem one of those occasions where, in one sense, it's been a very short time. It only seems a moment since Alistair was here and we had Bishop Michael, do whatever we did, license Tim as the team vicar here in the parish of East Greenwich. But one thing is incredibly different, and that is that we are the other way round. And that, if you like, is a sign of the transformation that Tim has brought in his ministry here. 6 years ago,
the church was faced that way. It looked very different. There was a beam, pews. Now we're facing the other way, and it does feel like that is an outward sign of an internal transformation and the new life that Tim's brought with his ministry here among us. So we want to give thanks for that and celebrate that today as we say farewell to Tim and as we kind of let go of him and he lets go of us. Our opening greeting. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. And we say together our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So we pause for a moment. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue in prayer with the words of the Collect. The Collect, the church's special prayer for the week. Tim has chosen the Bible readings today, so I chose the Collect, which I thought went best with Tim, and it's the Collect of the second Sunday before Lent. So let us pray. Almighty God, you have created the heavens and the earth and made us in your own image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works and your likeness in all your children. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns supreme over all things, now and forever. Amen. Please sit as Judith comes to read to us from our first reading.
And the first reading is from Isaiah chapter 65. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall be the days of my people. And my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labour in vain or bear children for calamity. For they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox. But the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountains, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now Jamil is going to come and read to us from the letter of James.
A reading from the letter of James. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say, have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. And Jamil was baptized by Tim a couple of weeks ago. We're going to have a musical interlude now, and Sue is going to play Bach accompanied by Joel. While they're getting themselves ready, I'll just remind you, of course, that sadly at the moment we are unable to sing as a congregation, and it is really disappointing because music's such an important part of Tim's life and a very important part of his ministry. For those of you who don't know, he used to be an organist at a church in a former life and played the organ and various other instruments. I'm sure you all know about the bagpipes throughout his life. So it's really disappointing that we can't all indulge ourselves in musical worship with Tim today, but I hope that this will be a contribution that will sort of stand in good stead instead. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Please would you stand as Julie comes to read our gospel reading.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice on that day, and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Father, we pray that as we look at your word, the written word, we pray that Jesus, the living word, would be more the clearer to us through the power of the Holy Spirit at work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Margaret, and the people of St. George's for the opportunity to come and be here for Tim's farewell service. Margaret hadn't very long been rector in her post at East Greenwich before she contacted me about the vacancy for a team vicar here within the team. And one of the potential candidates, she said, is an American from Chicago. There was something about he'd worked in the trade unions in the US. There was something about his journey to Anglicanism. There was something about being an Anglophile himself and his bonny English bride. I thought, this is going to be interesting. And it has been interesting over these last 6 years. And Tim has chosen for us tonight three readings, and I'm going to take just a little theme from each one of them. From the reading in Isaiah, starting a new thing. Well, Tim has never really been afraid to do that, clearly. His journey into ministry and subsequently to ministry in the UK are evidence enough of that. And Tim's never been afraid of starting a new thing here in Greenwich either. And so many more. I probably didn't communicate well on film. Sorry about that. The moving, turning the church around in its angles. God speaks in our Isaiah reading about a new heaven and a new earth where things are going to be done differently. A radical shift from how things have been done before. And there's an element about where we see some of that in evidence already, but we're clearly not there yet completely, because lambs still don't really eat with wolves, and lions aren't yet noted for eating hay. And there's quite a few other things about the New Jerusalem that Isaiah speaks of that are not yet in place, not even in Greenwich. But Tim strikes me as one who's never been afraid to try to do a new thing, especially when he understands that as be the right thing. So Tim, make sure that just because you're finishing this thing, that you don't stop. Continue to look to the God who does new things and step out, and you continue to do new things for him yourself too, wherever that may be and whatever it may mean. And then in James, we got faith without works is dead. The letter of James, it has to be said, has sometimes come under some criticism from some theologians for being a little bit too focused on works rather than on the faith. What was it, Martin Luther called it? He called it, I think, an epistle of straw. He didn't really have a very high opinion of it. There was nothing about the nature of the gospel, Martin Luther felt, in James's lesson. Well, that's a point, and it's a point that liberals shouldn't too swiftly dismiss either, as they often focus on this passage. However, the Jesus of the Gospels is often seen in very active mode, at work in the world, demonstrating the grace and mercy of God through what he, Jesus, was doing. For James and for Tim, faith without works is dead. There needs to be action that goes along with the faith. And Tim's work on behalf of refugees here in the Royal Borough of Greenwich, or working with the Winter Night Shelter and encouraging others from St. George's and the rest of the team to be involved. These are just some of the ways where faith and action have come together in very practical ways. I'm sure people here at St. George's and in the East Greenwich team altogether will have many examples to give of where Tim's faith and action, faith and works, have come together and been kept in balance. So Tim, may your faith and may our faith always be enlivened by and focused in our work as well. And may you and we never cease to bring our faith up front within the works that we're doing for God as well. And in Luke 6, we have blessings. And specifically in the passage that we've got, blessings on the poor. Jesus always had an eye out for the poor, for the orphan, the widow, the dispossessed, the outcast, and the refugee. And here in Luke's version of the Beatitudes, Jesus is looking out once again for the poor. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Looking out for the hungry, who will be filled, for those weeping, who will be laughing. These are all blessed. These are all subject to God's blessing them. Doesn't always look like it from the outside, but it's quite clear that's what Jesus is seeing here. And Jesus goes on to warn his followers that even when people hate you and exclude you and revile you and defame you on account of the Son of Man, still you are blessed. Indeed, rejoice and leap for joy. What a curious set of people that Jesus lists as those who are blessed. What a strange set of circumstances people were dealing with, and Jesus calls them blessed. What hopeful people, because God pours out his blessing on them. And of course, that's one of the specific things we expect of a priest as well. To bless. It's one of the things that comes at the end of the service that the priest is often asked to do, to bless God's people, to bless bread and wine. So, Tim, continue to give blessings. And, Tim, continue to be a blessing as well. And that's for you. But it's not just for you, because it's for us also that we too should be prepared to risk taking on new things, evidencing our work and our faith working together, and for us to bring God's blessing and to pray for God's blessing on those who we meet and work with too. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks because you call us to be people whose lives are changed by you doing a new thing. Lord, continue to do new things in us and help us to do new things with those around us too. We pray that you would help us in our work, that it would be founded on our faith, and that our faith will bubble through whatever it is that we are doing and others see us doing. And we pray for your blessing on us, and we pray that we will be a blessing to others, and we pray for your blessing to be on those that we work new things with. We pray that you be with Tim and with Caroline as they move to new things for them, and as they find new ways of ministering afresh. We pray that you will call each of us to find the new focus for our ministry at this stage. We ask that you would bless us, that we may be a blessing to others. In the name of Jesus, who blessed those who are around him and blesses us now too. Amen.
In response, let's stand and affirm our faith together. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness.
He bound himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross.
Therefore, God has raised him on high
and given him the name above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Can I invite you all to sit down, apart from Tim, who I'd like to invite to come and stand in the middle there at the moment. Alistair, could you come and stand the other side, please? So our brother Tim is leaving us to follow God's call to the next stage of his life. Today is a time to mark the ending of Tim's ministry in the parish of East Greenwich, a time to look back, and a time to look forward, a time for joy, and a time for sadness. And it is time to give thanks and praise to Almighty God for what Tim has given us in our lives together.
I thank everyone who parish of East Greenwich for the love, kindness, and support shown me over these last 6 years. I ask forgiveness for the mistakes I have made. I'm grateful for the way my service has been accepted. As I leave, I carry with me all that I have learned here.
We who receive your thankfulness, offer forgiveness, and accept that you now leave to minister elsewhere. We express our gratitude for your time among us. We ask forgiveness for our mistakes. Your influence on our faith and faithfulness will not leave us at your departure. Do you, the people of the parish of East Greenwich, and particularly the people of St. George's Westcombe Park, release Tim from his ministry?
We do, with the help of God.
Do you offer your encouragement to Tim in his retirement and future ministry at St. Albans Cathedral? Do you, Tim, release the people of this parish, and particularly the people from St. George's, from turning to you and depending on you?
I do.
Do you offer encouragement for the continued ministry here and for the relationship with others who will come to serve in future? We feel sorrow in your leaving and pray for you in this new phase of your life. We will miss your love and support, yet we know you will add much to the lives of those who you encounter in the future, as you have added much to our lives. I forgot to remind you about this next bit, so I don't know if you're ready or not.
Lord God, you have called us into being through love. You have joined us to one another in love. How good and how pleasant it is when your people dwell together in unity. Amen.
Can I invite you, Tim, temporarily to sit down again? So, we have a few tributes and words of appreciation from different people, some of them by video and some in real life. But first of all, the Right Reverend Caraway Dorgu, who's the Bishop of Woolwich, has sent a greeting.
Dearly beloved brothers and sisters in the East Greenwich team, I'm sorry I can't be with you at this time because this event is happening right in the middle of my vacation. But I was very delighted when your team rector, Margaret, asked me to send a few words by video clip. Thank you very much, Tim and Caroline, for all the hard work and many years of service of Christ and his people in Westcombe Park, St. George. It's a pity that I can't be with you personally as your area bishop to say thank you and goodbye. But I pray that the Lord will bless you, because I remember during my visit, as I sat and chatted with you in St. George, it was very obvious how much work you had put into literally turning the church round, both physically and spiritually. Thank you for the spiritual DIYs and the physical DIYs that you put into many years of service at St. George. May the Lord bless you for your meritorious years of service. I bring you these greetings as your area bishop on behalf of the diocese and Bishop Christopher. I pray that the Lord's peace will be with you during your retirement and that you go in his speed. And may the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and your loved ones, today and always. Amen.
And Tim's been active not only in church, but locally in all the different, in many, many different ways. And he's made really good friends with lots of people involved in local government. And our next tribute is from Councillor David Gardner, who Tim's got to know very well and who was very keen to send this through.
Hello, I'm Councillor David Gardner and just been asked to say a few words about the Reverend Tim Yeager, who unfortunately is about to retire. Good for him, unfortunate for the community. Tim is a force majeure. He may be a big man, but he has a huge heart. And there are two areas where I've got to know Tim. Firstly, in his great leadership in establishing Greenwich Refugees Welcome. From nothing, Tim put together groups from churches, Greenwich citizens, the mosque and so forth, to welcome our refugees from Syria under the Vulnerable Syrian Programme. And not only did he establish it, but he ensured that there was a real personal touch and support to those people that have come to our borough fleeing war, genocide, and so many different atrocities. And he's continued that for quite a few years now and continues to be very much at the centre of things, always prepared to speak out. The second area is Tim's role in Greenwich Winter Night Shelter, one of those churches, St. George's, that has been the mainstay of the night shelter over the last 2 years, providing a warm meal and a bed for the night, but most of all a warm welcome and company for those without homes who would otherwise be on the streets. And Tim is someone that's organised lectures, is someone who's really been a pillar of our community, but he really lives his Christian values. He speaks up for those who cannot speak for themselves, and he learns to do the right thing, to seek justice and defend the oppressed. I just hope, and I'm sure he will, Tim continues to do that in his retirement. So from the Greenwich Borough, many thanks, Tim, for everything you've done.
And another councillor, and this is Adele Kara, who Tim really got to know before he was a councillor as Tim's involvement with the Greenwich Islamic Centre. So Adele Carr is sending greetings in that capacity, really.
Assalamu alaikum. Dear Tim, thank you so much for all your support over the years. On behalf of Greenwich Islamic Centre and all the trustees, we are going to miss you dearly. Please do keep in contact with us, and we are looking forward to seeing you again sometime in the future. All the best, and God bless you.
And the final video tribute is from Tim's daughter, Aisha. And Tim, I've watched this twice. It's made me cry both times. So we'll get your handkerchief ready.
So when first Margaret reached out to me and said, you want to do a 2-minute video for your dad on his last day? I first thought, where's my bagpipes? Then I realized, I don't have bagpipes. So then I was thinking, well, maybe we can sacrifice the rooster. And then I thought, that's not going to make the cut for the church. So then I thought, well, why don't we just go find some trees to climb in and then freak you out while doing sit-ups in the trees. And while I was out looking for a tree to climb that would be safe enough after the derecho, I decided, why not just come down to the river, do the sit-ups on the old tree that's still here from all those years ago, and give you a shot of the Cedar River, because why not? That's what I'm doing here. I have now officially done enough sit-ups for the two of us for the next 5,000 years. So from now on, don't you worry about the bet. I have called it off. I have done enough work for it. So now you can go do work and keep volunteering, do what you love to do, because you've already made so much of a difference, but you can keep making the difference, and I know you're going to be bored to tears if you're not, because if there's people to save or to help, that's what you go out and do. And I'm going to keep doing what I can out here, working on J.D. Scholten's campaign. If Bernie decides to jump back in the race magically, then I'm, of course, going to be off to do that. But I'm going to keep doing my work, the work that I can do around the world. I know you're going to keep doing the same. So I hope that in some way or form that I can just keep doing as much work as you've done in your life to help as many people as possible. People, and of course, my preference, the planet. But I just wanted to make sure that you know that I love you, that I hope that you're having a great day, last day at your church. And I know the people over at St. Andrew's in Chicago are also sending their love, as well as people from the Union, from the movement, everywhere around the world. So, love you, Dad. Bye.
So, unfortunately, Matthew Pennycook, who's the MP for Greenwich and Woolwich, was unable to join us today and, in fact, is under huge pressure at the moment, so wasn't able to record a video. But he asked me to say to you, Tim, thank you so much for your years of service, for your generosity of spirit. And he says, his attempts to inject a bit more fun into his work. And Councillor Danny Thorpe, and the leader of the Royal Borough of Greenwich, was that's his chair there. He's clearly not here. I know it's a very busy weekend for him because the Greenwich is the first borough in the country to be running an outdoor festival at the moment, and I suspect he's probably caught up with that. But I know that he intended to be here if he could and would send his greetings and I'm sure he'd add to all the things that everyone else has already said. Mark, would you like to come and pay tribute?
Our message from the Westing Council is very simple. We've loved working with you over the last 6 years, both you and Carolyn, and you've enriched our work and the lives of the community in great ways. For the people who don't know how we've interacted maybe with Tim over the 6 years, it's been our steadfast sort of anchor when it's come to our Christmas carol services and provided us with kind of drama tasks and with spiritual leadership, but also joyous occasions at Christmas. And one of the things I would take from Tim Brett's words at those occasions is that he also approaches familiar themes of Christmas stories, but with a kind of different perspective. And I find that very rewarding. And of course, that was Tim's guarantees the countryside travel is also really, really wonderful. The other thing that Tim gets involved with lighting up the house, is actually as part of our Burns House celebrations. And you probably experienced the same thing that we have, as Tim is quite an extraordinary and loud magpie performer. I mean, you may be whiskey on the evening, but actually, Tim's contribution is always the highlight of that kind of event, so that's kind of a great thing for us. But when we learned that sadly Tim was retiring from St. George's, we discussed it with part of our team in the office, and one of the great thing that came out of that really is that we discussed that we from the age of and growing from Tim's contribution to our organisation and of course the benefit of the community, which you know all about. But what we said, when we asked ourselves what we thought were actually the characteristics of both that we enjoyed through Tim, the personal characteristics that we enjoyed through Tim, were also the kind of characteristics that we want any successor to have as well. We pinpointed maybe a few things that perhaps Tim had brought in a kind of joyous way to our work as a kind of community. And it's just a few of those things that, you know, his kind of humility, the humour that he injects into everything that he does, and the fact that actually he's a man who lives by his actions as well as his words. And I think that, you know, we're all hugely grateful and impressed by the fact that, you know, his actions speak louder than his words, I think, the sort of the dark shadow from the work of the Syrian community, which we certainly imagine has been incredibly grateful and impressed by. And I think that, you know, anybody who wants to come take over the mantle has got a hell of a job on their hands to go and follow that. So we want, from us, and we want to wish you well, thank you, Caroline, but we also want you to know that you're always welcome to come back, and we greatly enjoy and been enhanced by your involvement for us, and that's both something to rejoice and also sorry.
And Ahmed is going to come and speak on behalf of the Syrian refugees family. So it's wonderful to have someone who can speak from first-hand experience about all the things we've been hearing about. So thank you, Ahmed. You're very welcome to take your mask off now so we can hear you.
Okay. I'm very proud of myself to be here at this meeting. I want to talk briefly about my wonderful relationship with Mr. Tim. He was one of the first persons we met him in the airport when we came to him. And he said, at that time, my wife was crying because, as you know, when you leave your country, to go to different countries, different languages. So Mr. Tim said at that time, no one would argue with our family. So this sentence made something special in my mind. So he is a wonderful man. Believe me, I'm not so speak that because we are face to face. So I'm speaking that from my experience with Mr. Tim. And he never hesitated to provide any help to the Syrian family. I really appreciate what he has done for us. I'm very glad and so same time, because we hear that instantly will give us to another country. Sorry, I'm so sorry, and excuse me for my English.
We're very impressed with your English, Ahmed. And now the St George's Church Wardens, Helen and Janet, are going to come forward.
On the 5th of March 2014, well, I was actually standing roughly about where Tim, Margaret's husband, is at the back. The whole Frick family was there in force. It was Hannah's baptism that day and First Communion. Richard and I were very lucky to be asked to be two of her godparents. And after the service, Kate said, "Hey, you see that tall guy that stood at the back, head and shoulders above everyone else? Well, he's visiting us for the first time in view of becoming our House for Duty minister. Now, you must have made a really good impression on everyone, because here you are 6 years later and we stood here again, but this time with your wardens, and on behalf of everyone at St George's, we are saying goodbye and a huge thanks for everything you've done."
My initial awareness of Tim was that he was tall. Well, he was tall and a bit scary, you know, for being so tall. And I remember he at his first PCC meeting, he wore a captain's hat and said he was the captain of the ship, which was, in this instance, Church of St. George's. And as the captain, he has guided us through uncharted waters, through small changes and bigger changes, with kindness and steadfastness in working to help St. George's grow. Through a variety of activities, such as clearing rubbish, stopping the jumble sale, which definitely upset the other part, getting rid of the big red beam, turning the church around so it was a church again, helping with painting, being handy with his chainsaw to make the church more visible, radically getting rid of the pew that was radical, dealing with faculties, and heard to quote on a number of occasions, "Not another bloody faculty," when he was gently reminded he needed a faculty. And his vision in creating a space for a community garden which had blossomed with wildflowers. He threw himself wholeheartedly into the life of St. George's, sharing of himself, his time and his talents, from playing the piano to his bagpipes, and who can never forget a Palm Sunday, with Tim leading the way on the bagpipes. You might not be singing the same song as what Tim's playing, but you followed him around the neighbourhood. Tim was great at encouraging all musical talent among the younger congregation, and we'll hear later from Freddie in the service, so thank you for that. Tim encouraged the employment of a new musician, Joel, which has taken the choir into new spheres. His kindness and willingness to go above and beyond to help and assist with the variety of needs that arose over the years. He was always available with a cup of tea, or most likely wine. St. George's Bancroft estate goes down extremely well, I can vouch. I leave my car at home. He gave us an awareness of a broader community and tirelessly worked to improve relationships within this, working with the council, Muslim communities, Syrian refugees, Mycenae House, and many, many others. And for this, he was given a civic award from Greenwich, of which we were all proud for him. As well as setting up lecture series covering topics from Romans to lectures from our own members of our congregation, Jane and Neville Grant, Sam Warhead, Ed Mayo, to the more controversial talks by Jane Ozon, Jeffrey Johnstall, and Bob Rees, as well as having film nights holding weddings, baptisms, and funerals.
though he's teaching on, through his teaching on a variety of topics, I most remember and enjoyed Outstanding Women of the Bible, or Uppity Women, as Dr. Ruth Wolfe called them, where I learned subtext is a text without context becomes pretext. Anna, it is getting ingrained within the grey cells. The most interesting, well, they were all quite fascinating, was the study of the Song of Solomon. Oh my giddy, I have never, ever laughed so much in my life. And Caroline had to come down and say just what all the noise was about. A quote I was given yesterday is so very apt today. Tim, you heard it this morning, so it's not going to be a surprise. Tim, the church is here to comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable. Tim, you have certainly done that and made us all think and reevaluate, and we thank you for that.
Tim also did the Galilee course. He wrote it and it was done in 2018 and 2019. And this was written by him, and through this, it deepened our understanding of God and his love for us. Sitting around a simple meal helped us to get to know new people and make friends. Tim has an ability to let you be as you are, with no agenda or pressure, allowing you to find your way through listening and asking.
He encouraged us in accepting people as they are, no matter what their race, creed, sexuality or needs. We joined the Progressive Christian Network and also One Body and One Faith. The most progressive thing I found and learned is that love that is manifested in Jesus, and if we are to continue to grow and progress, we need to allow this love to encompass us, to give the willingness to learn new things, accept changes and challenges, and move forward. This was demonstrated last year when St. George's, for the first time, participated in the Gay Pride Parade in London. I had reached the grand old age of 65 before ever going on a demonstration, but I was really proud to be part of St. George's that day. Tim was absolutely fantastic in working with children, having the ability to get down on their level and encouraging them in everything they did. Beth wore a moustache on the next Sunday after Tim had grown his two hairy caterpillars together. He encouraged the children to dance down the aisle to the hymns and often joined in on the processional hymn with Poppy and the other youngsters. Jamail, Tim was so happy to have been able to baptise you and your sister Nikki before today. And thank you so much for reading that lesson.
Mrs. Bigger. Who has been Tim's rock and stability throughout the years, quietly and unobtrusively directing operations. One of the best memories of Caroline is standing with her, is of her standing in the green bin during the clear up day. She will be missed by members of the choir for her zeal and her vast knowledge of music, and can be often be found each Sunday sitting in the naughty row trying to look like an angel at the back of church. She has always been willing to help out and stand in whenever needed, sorting flowers, doing the prayers, reading, standing in at short notice, and a sense of humour guaranteed to lighten a moment. And also, Caroline, you've been a good friend, and I'll miss our walks.
We thank Tim and Caroline for the time that you've spent with us. You will both be sorely missed, but with our love and prayers, wish you both joy and happiness as you set forth in your new adventures.
You need to open it.
Well,
oh, I have to open it.
Yes, come on, yes. Yes, come on, let's open.
Thank you.
can't give a preacher the microphone or an opportunity to say something and then just, you know, start looking at your watch. You know, there's a joke. A man took his son to church for the first time. And he said, "Daddy, what does it mean when the minister goes like this?" He says, "Son, well, that means stand up." "What does the minister mean when he goes like this?" He says, "Well, that's when the minister wants you to sit down." "Daddy, what does it mean when the minister takes off his watch and puts it on the pulpit?" He says, "Sadly, son, it doesn't mean a thing." Well, we can tell that one for a while. Friends, thank you for this day. It would be a hard one. Made it a little easier. Thanks to Margaret for all the work you did. It put us together. I didn't see I should come. I was taking a look for that. What maybe you didn't catch is that I have a depth of here, but if I started volunteering for something new within 60 days of my retirement, I would have to do 100 sit-ups. And so she just took care of that debt, sort of like an issue. So I guess I can volunteer now. Don't have to do the sit-ups, although the sit-ups would be good. I just want to say that it's gone by quickly. But you were worth crossing the Atlantic for. This is a research was correct. This is a wonderful community. This is a wonderful church. I wouldn't swap you guys for anything. And I'll carry with me so many hot memories. Glad to see here some of the young people we got confirmed with us, and some of the people that we baptized. That feels good. I want to thank the team that invited me here, originally Bishop Michael Alistair, our archdeacon, Margaret led the team, and especially the two lay residents of St. George's, Judith Eastlaw and Chris Gate. I didn't entirely know what I was getting into, but I had an idea. Because when we came that first Sunday for Hannah's baptism or first communion, I can't remember what it was, something like that.
First communion.
We got here just as the service was starting, and we picked out an empty pew. We went to Judith or director as a general direction, but I don't blame it for the pew. The pew was empty, so we thought it was a good thing to sit on. Can you understand that? And we sat on it like that. And so I said to Caroline, "Move to the other end." We got good reviews. So thank you for calling. This actually has been the only time I've had a full-time ministry. You were it. And thank you for that opportunity. We're not dead. We have to leave the parish. You have to think about our experience together, consider the ways of the future, think about your direction, think about who you might want to call next. And I need to give space for that. But we're not so far away. And I do look forward to getting to the day when this pandemic is passed, we can have a proper St. George's party with hugs and really excellent food and drink like we do here at St. George's. So with that, I want to thank you all for the best 6 years we've had. Wish you the best for the future.
A little unusually, our prayers of intercession are going to be led by video. Ed Mayo and Courtney Plank. Ed was going to lead the prayers of intercession in real life today, but they were in France, and as you all know, when you come back from France now, you have to quarantine. So unfortunately, they can't be here today. They are only around the corner, but they can be here virtually.
The response to the words, "Lord, holy is your name," is, "Hear our prayer." Our souls
magnify the Lord, and our spirits rejoice in God our Saviour, for you have looked with favour on the lowliness of us, your servants. We know that you have done great things for all. We know that you have done great things for us here through Tim and Caroline. Bless us and all who follow your call to love, now and in generations to come. Lord, holy is your name. Hear our prayer. Your mercy is for those who fear you. You show strength with your arm, you scatter the proud. Show us mercy, dissolve our pride, and give us the resolve to be the best that we can be. Lord, holy is your name. Hear our prayer. You bring down the powerful from our thrones, from our wealth, and from our conceits, and you lift up the lowly. Give us courage to take risks, to stand up for the truth, and to stand up to those in power. Lord, holy is your name. Hear our prayer. You fill the hungry with good things, and you send the rich away empty. Inspire us to act, to stand in solidarity with those who are poor, with those who face injustice. Lord, holy is your name. Hear our prayer. You have helped your servant Israel. In remembrance of your mercy, according to the promise made to Abraham and his descendants forever. And in line with your promise, help us to be a true church, in the spirit of the Song of Mary, a church that is inclusive, risk-taking, and prophetic. Lord, holy is your name. Hear our prayer.
Bless us, show us mercy, give us courage, inspire us to act and help us to be a true church. We ask this in recognition of your favour already, in recognition of the gifts we have received from you through Tim and Caroline, and so that we can magnify your name. We plead, merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
So I'm going to invite you to remain seated as we share the peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God. We meet in the name of Christ and share in his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you with saints and angels praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends, and taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, Take, eat. "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised you, gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with George and all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. We continue in prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Everyone is welcome to come forward and to receive. At the moment, we're only able to administer communion in one kind, so there's one wafer to receive. And if you come forward as invited by the sides people, one at a time, and keep your social distance. If you prefer to come forward and receive a prayer of blessing, when you get to the front, just keep your hands by your side, and the wafer will be placed into your hands without touching you. Thank you. Let's stand to pray. God, our Creator, by your gift, the tree of life was set at the heart of the earthly paradise, and the bread of life at the heart of your church. May we who have been nourished at your table on earth be transformed by the glory of the Saviour's cross and enjoy the delights of eternity. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you and those you love, now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.